talk, and people who don't like to talk won't talk.
But one thing I'd love, though, is to get just some of our panelists who haven't had a chance to comment yet, just to get your thoughts about anything that you'd like to comment on. Ed Boyden, I actually wondered if you had any thoughts on the last session or just more broadly in that area of neuroscience.
Yeah, sure. Couple thoughts. I mean, we're talking a lot about throughput, screens, assays. You know, what do we want to see? How do we see it at scale? And how do we integrate the data? And so, couple thoughts. One is that it's very interesting to think about how different techniques and preparations connect to each other. Can they be integrated into a workflow? And we're talking a lot about different technologies, but can they be unified in some way? One thing we're just playing with in our group, I don't know if it generalizes the topics here, but can we really build a pipeline where we do live imaging, live mapping of RNA and transcriptome and proteomic and other kinds of data, and then find some way to integrate all that data in a unified way over time? The other thing also is, if we're talking about systematic screens at scale, are there any principles that, you know, thinking backwards from the goal, that might be fun to think about in terms of, you know, the resolution or the multiplexing or the throughput that would help us choose technologies or ways to integrate them. So yeah, we've been thinking a lot about thinking backwards from end goals lately, and how technologies can be brought together.
I was going, in fact, to suggest exactly the same. This seems like a great opportunity to think about different types of assays and how to standardize them and make them robust, in a comparative manner. So, you know, and anything from electrophysiology, and when you start to think about layering genetic information in large numbers of people, this seems like a perfect opportunity to also for the community to come up with standards and as well as platforms that can take you to the next stage.
Yeah, hey, I'd like to make a comment. I don't know how to raise my hand here except to do this. So I approach things from the pharmacological point of view. I'm always thinking of assays that can accommodate chemical libraries. And the problem with neuroscience has always been, from my days at Merck all through NIH, is you can't really generate the throughput you need to investigate the chemical library space that we have available to us today. So I was wondering if, things like synaptic surrogates, for example, in a nematode model or something, that an organism of that size, which we could actually do in high throughput screening with hundreds of thousands of compounds with full dose response relationships, could be a starting point for at least collecting chemical matter of interest to this community, then to testing what I would consider all secondary assay type model systems that you've described here. Nothing is extremely high throughput that I've seen today. For the kind of work I normally do. And I was just wondering what people think about that.
Just a comment about what Ed said. I think your comment really does provide a nice segue into bullet point 3 on the screen here that we're supposed to be discussing. You know, you said, can you chain these tools together in some kind of pipeline? And insofar as that pipeline leads from very systematic screens to in-depth lower throughput technologies, that is exactly what bullet point 3 here wants us to discuss. I thought this was one of the more interesting, this is like my favorite bullet point, I think, maybe together with the AI machine learning one. But and does it require central coordination, I think is the other pretty interesting discussion. Can NIH, should they be, matchmaking and creating these workflows programmatically, or do we all somehow need to do it? And to what degree are we already somehow doing it?
Yeah.
Here's a question for both of you and everyone. Do we have the conventions we need as a field to have routinely interoperable data sets, and such that algorithms like those that Alexis described and others could sort of surf across a whole field's worth of data? And if not, what would it take to get there? What would we what would we need to do as a, what would we need as a field to agree to? How should that happen?
Alexis, are you on? You want to comment?
I am on. So the question is, how would we get to a point where we can agree to share things at that scale, Steve?
Yeah, and also, are there, would we need conventions on file formats?
Yeah.
And what would get us to where we need to be?
I think a lot of computational labs are equipped to handle issues like minor differences in file formats and things like that, but just access and ability to download and share between collaborators more smoothly, you know, something where anybody who had approval to get the data could share with each other, could share their processed version, could share derived data and things like that in a more easy way, would be fantastic. You know, of course, more consistency in file formats never hurts anyone, but I think that's something that we're more prepared to deal with ourselves in our own labs, and we can't solve the issues of just simply how to share quickly and seamlessly and how to get access and how to make it easy for people to upload and share their data as well, right?
Is it just
this is related to the point I was making on the previous at the end of the previous meeting.
I'm not sure if Haki is also on, but she raised this point a little bit as well.
I would just add my voice to that as well.
I agree that, you know, easy access, but the systematic like interoperability is important too, because, you know, it is true that we can, you know, massage and handle the data, but sometimes you just don't do it because it's too much work, right? So, I mean, there has to be some kind of effort, systematic effort to make data, I don't know, like ontologies or, so that it's easy for analysts or anybody to kind of ask the questions and be able to answer the questions right away. I feel like there's a lot of wasted time in formatting data from one lab to the other ones. And it's true, we can do it, but, you know, it's all a matter of bandwidth. We don't have infinite bandwidth to answer these questions.
Having conventions about annotations, you know, things like sample IDs, so you can easily cross-reference, you know, multiple data types from the same individual, and annotations about data of collection and things like that, that we always sort of need to have. If there were standards on that, it would help tremendously.
Even genome build would be a good start.
More pairing of computational scientists and biologists too, because it's a pretty quick learning curve that you find out if you want your data to be analyzed in this integrative way, then you have to generate it and format it in certain ways. And that's what I found people in my lab have learned pretty quickly.
Yeah, I think it's a much more difficult thing to actually implement it than, you know, think about it. It's like a general librarian or a Google, you know, type of thing that allows you to systematically, you know,
This is why, you know, bioinformatics and Python skills are going to be, you know, huge bullet points in people's resumes for the near future. I think you kind of have to have that skill set. And you also have to have the knowledge, you know, to HK's point, you have to have the knowledge of where these data sets are. I think for us, you know, a big part of it is having the right collection of postdocs who can tell you, oh, I just read this paper and that's a great data set. Why aren't you guys using it? And that comes up in lab meeting. And I feel privileged to have that postdoc in lab meeting, but is there a more systematic way to have a clearinghouse of these things? I mean, to offer a counterpoint, I get the willies every time these discussions about data formats and standards come up, because I think, as some of you on the call know, the landscape at the NIH is littered with failed attempts or partially failed attempts to standardize things. And maybe it eventually happens, but after hundreds of people spend years in rooms who largely aren't biologists, by the way, I mean, it's a different breed these things attracts as well. And I think right now, in this meeting, for instance, the mindshare has correctly been on how you analyze the data, because that's where, you know, we should be thinking.
But, yeah, we're up to 121 people.
We're ready to go.
Good.
Sounds like they're ready to.
Sorry, you're not on me.
I know. Yep. So yeah, we're ready to go with the breakout groups. So just stand by for 1 second.
How long should we go now that we're a little behind? Hello.
Ita, maybe 10 more minutes.
Yeah, I agree with the incentives part. There's really not incentives to make things, you know, to share the data in a way that other people can, you know, effectively use.
It would be nice if there were some bioinformatics staff attached to major consortium efforts, you know, shared not just within a single lab or institute, but really shared that their job was to help you know, put the data in forms that most people would want.
Yeah, and continuity, right? You kind of, you know, train someone that knows a lot about things and then they leave and then you have to start from scratch, right? And that's how we work in with this funding.
Yeah, I just like to say, I think the problem is extremely, you know, it's an extreme problem because it's a fundamental kind of not acceptance of the need for infrastructure to support the complexity of the system.
But it's incentives, right? You don't get paid. I wrote multiple grants that didn't get discussed because
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? The breakout rooms are open. So you should have gotten an alert. I see one on my screen. So you have to click and join your breakout. So you're assigned. So let's keep it to 25 minutes, and we may have to extend beyond 4:30. I apologize for this technical difficulties we faced today. Thank you for your additional 10 minutes of time. I hope you join the breakouts. See you soon.
It would be good if you could pick up that that thread, conceptual thread again about you know, data coordination, because I think it's really important.
I feel like I'm being moved around virtual space here somehow.
Yeah, we just got kicked back in.
Yeah.
That was beautiful. That was abrupt.
That hurts.
Yeah, exactly. What the heck's going on in cyberspace here?
Yeah, it was like, you're out.
And then yeah, you're exactly.
Before I can finish my...
I hope nobody got dizzy. So
we actually might find ourselves in a Google kind of tech meeting. Who knows?
It's kind of like Star Trek, you know, being in the transporter dissolving. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. I think we have all joining back the main room. So it's now report out from the moderators of each session, each breakout session. Please go ahead.
We can start with Dan and Nicole.
Okay. My head's still spinning from that quick transition, but I would say we tried to get through all the questions. It was very difficult with 4 minutes for each of them in the time allotted. But what I'm going to do is just very quickly summarize and let other people chime in and modify. Rather than going through question by question, I'm just going to summarize some of the points of agreement, mention a couple of ideas, and a couple of gaps. So loci, you know, the key issue, huge advances in GWAS and identifying loci, but the key is to identify the causal variants and the genes, and those two things are really key intermediate steps that are probably, you know, best done in kind of high throughput and large scale. Of course, the effect of a locus and its function may vary over time and space, and that has to be brought into consideration and adds a level of complexity that has to be recognized, both developmental time and then the state of the tissue in terms of learning state or sleep, et cetera. Everybody agreed that integration is the most exciting area. This notion of the interface between kind of basic developmental biology and genetics and disease and kind of figuring out mechanisms that pull those things together. They really need each other to understand how genetic loci actually come together and work, especially in the age of polygenicity. It causes a lot of challenges, but the notion of bringing together the biologists and geneticists and modelers in kind of moderate size MPI type projects seem to be widely endorsed. And again, we can get into more details, but I think another agreement is that four studies aiming at studying kind of these complex diseases, whether it's an individual investigator, you know, unless it's a highly detailed study, but for the kind of, you know, for this larger questions that are being asked here, a small n or n of one is kind of out for these studies. We kind of have to identify what that middle ground is, but kind of more n is going to help you understand in terms of number of genes, number of variants, you know, being studied. There has to be, you know, there are going to be different levels of analysis there, right? Obviously, but kind of maybe one at a time, you know, is not the optimal way to go about sifting through these diseases. That doesn't mean you don't want to fund investigators studying a gene or a gene product. Of course you do, because you have to understand it. But in the context of the questions being asked here for kind of broad, you know, translating genetics into biology, one should probably favor the larger end kind of studies. One idea brought up about solving, you know, part of this issue of sharing information and stuff and ideas is to kind of use a Reddit kind of posting board. And that was, Hey Kyung brought that up. I thought it was very interesting. We all kind of liked it, you know, where one can kind of have an ongoing posting and discussion and voting. There were three, you know, there are a lot of gaps, and I'm sure a lot of the other groups are going to discuss them. One of the clear issues is although we kind of measure transcriptomes and we measure proteomes and we put all this together and identify EQTL and PQTL, the modulation of gene activity in space and time is a kind of dimension that hasn't been well studied. And that's going to be, again, really, really essential. I think it also integrates with some of the other comments earlier. One of the issues is more understanding of human circuits. Like when you're doing a high throughput screen, right? We can do all these screens now. And if you wanted to do a drug screen, what are you actually trying to fix? And it's at a neurobiological level. And for most of these disorders, we don't even know in the human brain what a normal millimeter of cortex really looks like at a, you know, at a molecular level or even at a synaptic level, although those kind of things are being built, let alone how that might be disrupted in disease. Now, even if we did know that, some of that is going to be static information, but we'd be much better off than where we are right now, where we don't kind of even yet have a human kind of ground truth that we're trying to model in many cases. And again, things that are going on at the Allen Institute and other studies like that are going to be very helpful there. So kind of studying little bits of tissue with high resolution was one of the points brought up. And also this notion of you know, potentially one way to also approach this is to combine studies where you have developmental biologists working in model systems who have developed interesting assays and who have a lot of knowledge with kind of people who study the human genetics or human disease and kind of putting those together in projects where there's a kind of iterative kind of approach would be quite valuable as well. And that was brought up by Randall Peterson. We agreed with the issues of kind of consortia are kind of necessary, but you can't only have consortia. They're very useful for map making and for identifying key resources and building them. So especially where maps are needed, protein assembly stuff was very, area of interest as well. But I think I've probably exceeded my 5 minutes or 4 minutes. So I'd like to see if there are any other comments from the folks in my group or if Nicole wants to add something that I missed.
No, I think you've done a great job summarizing discussion.
Thank you, Dan. So we'll move to the next panel. Who is next? But Nevin?
Yeah, we'll do, Jennifer and I will do a tag team. I'll let Jennifer take the lead and then I'll add at the end.
Sure, great. Thanks, Nevin. So first of all, we had great fun in the last half an hour and covered a broad range of topics. I think the emerging theme from our group is that people are most excited about this notion of linking things across length scales, and that if we could go from genes to RNA to protein-protein interactions at the synapse up to circuits and then all the way to behavior and somehow link these length scales, that would really be, I think, where the sentiment is that the magic will start to happen in terms of discovery. One of the main points that was brought up is that it would be amazing if there could be synergy across diseases and if we could learn lessons from genetic studies in other diseases to begin to think about how to apply to a neurological disease. But a key barrier in taking this approach was very important, which is you can take iPS cells and turn them, for example, into cardiomyocytes as fast as 2 weeks, and they're quite homogeneous. However, in the case of the brain, we're dealing with an extremely long timescale in vitro, and this can be quite refractory to this notion of drawing parallels. And in fact, I think it was raised by Pasca that people are turning sort of rapidly to direct reprogramming approaches for the notion that you can get semi-homogeneity of cell cultures as well as speed things up a little bit instead of having organoids in culture for such a long time. The other big theme that emerged for us, which I think is probably going to be raised by everyone, is the idea that really it's critical to start with the phenotype and get the right cell type, the correct circuit, the right developmental window, as well as the timing dynamics. And I think we just had about five main points that we tended to focus around that the group in general thought were so very important. The first is the issue of timescales. So it was raised that in the brain in particular, activation of circuits is happening on timescales of milliseconds or even shorter. However, on the molecular side, we then characterize on minutes, hours, days, even weeks. and thinking about how not only to get the right cell type, but then in neuronal activation scenarios, finding just the precise timing. And I, in my own group, have seen long-range looping interactions and epigenetic marks that are indeed functional happening so quickly, and then they're gone. And so if you don't get the time scale just right, and how to bridge with the activation time scale, the functionality might be missed. The second thing is that there was a quite vigorous discussion around taking a bottom-up versus a top-down approach, with the idea that should we be doing functional genomics if in fact we still aren't sure what synaptic property we should be assaying, and should we put all our effort now into protein-protein interactions at the synapse, characterizing them and ensuring that the protein composition at the synapse actually matches what is expected, and then seeing how that's perturbed in disease, and then finally using that as the quantitative trait to then begin to bring in these very elegant large-scale approaches. And I think the pushback from that approach was that, look, we can go both bottom-up and top-down and begin to meet in the middle to make some progress. Another big area that we sort of focused and centered around is at which length scale to look in the brain to start, and emphasis from many on the call that I thought was really, I learned a lot from it, is in thinking that looking at the synapses might be too granular, and in fact they're so very plastic over time and undergo homeostatic plasticity that could we even be sure that starting at that level could give us a meaningful readout, and in fact perhaps we could start at ensuring we're working in systems where we know the circuit. And then my understanding, it went very quickly, is that once we know the circuit, and then we can understand how a particular genetic variant alters the circuit, it might be possible to then begin to quantify things such as dendritic arborization or other type of dendrite size, morphology, or shape features. One last thing is that there was a closing sort of discussion about what we can do in organoids in terms of getting functional circuits, inducing plasticity, LTP, if we need to know the protein properties of the synapse before we even begin to think about inducing LTP. And I think the emerging theme that I took away was just how important it is for all of us as a community to think about the functional readouts and the synaptic readouts and the circuit readouts, and which things we really need to hone in on as phenotypic traits to begin to unravel the genetics and epigenetics. How about you, Nevin?
You did much better than I could have. I'll just quickly add about two quick things across different disease areas, which is something I'm personally very excited about, but obviously the realization at the cellular level, there's complexity there, but at the molecular level, especially if you've even studied in vitro, some of these are the same proteins across these different disease areas. So more synergy across disease areas, I think, is something that's incredibly exciting. And then, yeah, the big discussion about what's the right cellular model. When I go on these neuro calls, that's most of what's discussed nowadays is, okay, what cells should we be working in? What model should we work in? And I actually see it as a plus, because there's different things to choose from. And it was brought up that networks are going to change depending on the cell type you look at. And I actually think that's an exciting thing. So I think we do have to generate these type of networks, including protein-protein interaction networks, in a number of different cellular systems. We can do it temporally and spatially, even more exciting. And then the idea of just converging bottom-up, top-down, meeting in the middle, to me, that's very exciting, a very exciting prospect in this particular area. So that's all I wanted to add.
Cool. It was fun.
Thanks, Jennifer and Nevin. You should move to the next breakout group. Richard?
So that's Ellen and I, and Ellen's agreed to report out because I'll be leading the next moderating the next discussion.
Sure. So yeah, we had an interesting discussion, followed along the bullet point questions. Some of the points were already brought up from the other groups, but four of the main points of discussion, first regarding the public-private collaborations. I think everyone thinks that these are having more collaborative networks across groups, I think is essential. And there's definitely a need for more sharing of data that Alexis in our group mentioned, that, you know, sharing more and sharing earlier is going to be very relevant. But this can also present challenges when trying to interface with the private sector, where they might have particular specific questions in mind that they want to address. So I think Ed and our group also came up with a really interesting idea that if the NIH or if journals would require the sharing of data more and earlier, and also sort of serve as sort of a matchmaker between not only public and private, but also sort of within academia, if there could be sort of a matchmaker process in that regard, that could also be helpful in fostering collaborations. And the second question that we talked about with regard to the second question, how do we identify specific disease mechanisms and move from screens to mechanisms? I think one question that we had some discussion about is which phenotypes to focus on. I think this has come up in a lot of discussion, sort of what are the druggable targets, if phenotypes can vary, is any phenotype relevant? And I think through our discussion came to the conclusion that we do anticipate that there will be convergence across risk genes, and we see phenotypes in multiple assays as being an entry point. I think Anne made the point in our group that that any phenotype could really be an entry point into understanding a relevant disease mechanism. And that sort of gets to our third major area, which was how to prioritize genes. How do we prioritize the findings for more in-depth, lower throughput technologies? And here, I think Ed and Stefan had some really interesting ideas about the NIH really sort of setting up a criteria for prioritizing genes that could be very helpful and informative for neuroscientists who maybe are less familiar with the genetic studies. And so Ed suggested sort of using the Brain Initiative as a model, as a guide for sort of building a consortium. And Stefan suggested maybe having the NIH suggest a list of priority genes that we could sort of group into sort of the, if you have a low throughput assay, which genes do you want to study versus a medium throughput versus high throughput, if you can study 100 genes at once in your system, which are the genes to target. And it might be helpful for NIH to provide criteria in that regard. And that's something else we could probably discuss in the larger group discussion. And finally, I think the final point is really how important it is to integrate across different platforms and to integrate the genetics and neuroscience and to really go from the molecular to the cellular to the circuit, as I think everyone's been discussing. But also I brought up the importance of really not forgetting the clinical data and the need for deep phenotyping of individuals who are affected with the different disorders, and really to do that along a developmental trajectory and really to use our data integration to really go from the genetics and molecular all the way up to clinical clinical population and deep phenotyping of affected individuals as well. So I don't know, Richard, if there are other points. I think that was sort of a broad overview of what we discussed, but there are other points that I missed you want to bring up.
I think that's great. I particularly like the idea of modeling some kind of organization on the Brain Initiative, bringing groups together from different backgrounds to tackle specific genes or specific groups of genes at different levels and integrate their online in real time their results and share that as they progress.
Thanks, Ellen and Richard. We'll move to the fourth breakout session, moderators, Shreya and Olga.
So we're also going to tag team. I'll just start and then Trey jump in whenever or he'll finish. We talked a lot actually across questions, and one of the key efforts that we think is really important in answering both the question of how to select and prioritize findings, what research mechanism would be useful, and even the question of integrating genetics and neuroscience, we felt that what was really needed is a serious effort for data coordination. And perhaps that may be actually a perfect mechanism to do central coordination from the NIH perspective. We felt it was really critical to have the most possible, you know, the most open possible access and aiming towards interoperable file formats, but most importantly, having a lot of information on the metadata, et cetera, for these data sets. As well as, you know, while this may be a tall order, really thinking at least of starting an investigation into some form of knowledge graph structures to capture basically our understanding with some depth to it. So there was a suggestion to perhaps have a study group to investigate this. But at the very least, really having serious metadata that will make these data sets available to people and possible to analyze. We were pretty open on the specific mechanisms of how this would be implemented as long as it really encourages open access and data sharing. But one specific possibility might be even something like an RFA that would ask for collaborative interdisciplinary teams, at least for the question of selecting and prioritizing screens in selective areas. And one critical question that kept coming up and up again was really thinking in addition to the specific functional questions and genetic questions, the question of zeroing in into cell types and assays that would need to be prioritized. What came up multiple times was the need to really not make assumptions of what cell types and contexts matter and really open that to investigation and let the data tell us. And that was sort of the key of questions that we discussed. And Trey, do you want to take over and round this out?
Sure. I thought that was a really good summary, and maybe all I will add is to this last point about, which is really bullet point three here, how do we select and prioritize findings from systematic screens and funnel them, you know, it's this funnel image being invoked here into progressively, you know, medium throughput and then lower throughput single gene protein molecule assays, but those that have a lot of, you know, detailed information, kind of like the discussion about, you know, the throughput of genetic interrogation versus structure that we had in discussion this morning. Those different approaches are along a continuum of systematic versus depth. You know, whereas one day we do think, you know, I would certainly think that one would like to contemplate something like a human genome project scale effort where you coordinate, you know, you look at the function of these variants in these different neuropsychiatric diseases in a very coordinated way. We definitely felt like we're not yet to the stage of NIH saying, you know, you sequence chromosome 5. You center sequence chromosome 12, but that we still need to let flowers bloom. And so that kind of led to Olga's proposal there to you know, could we contemplate an RFA along the lines of this bullet point three, but where you specify key review criteria that the proposal has to meet, but stop short of saying, you know, these are the particular technologies we want to see. Again, maybe down the road we can move to that, but we felt like we're not there yet, but we are in a very important era here of realizing that sequencing itself isn't going to give us the solution, but we need to bring in an interdisciplinary, inter-data modal approach. So maybe I'll rest on that. And
thank you, Trey and Olga. So I would now turn this over to Richard to moderate roundtable discussion.
Sure. So this final roundtable really is to come up with a set of concrete opportunities for short-term and long-term to make transformative advancements on how we approach genes biology at the scale of depth that has not been done before, and identify what framework mechanisms collaborative science versus other mechanisms going forward. So that's our task. And so I really wanted to open this up for discussion to all the panelists. And I think we've had a great day, and I'll try to summarize it later. You know, I think if we think about maybe start the discussion on short term, so, you know, what can we do now? You know, is there anything we can do now to really, you know, start the process of interrogating specific genes or alleles and testing them? What is the best approach for that? And then maybe move on to more long-term approaches. I mean, I'll say I have a particular bias, which I've expressed before, that looking at the de novo mutations and the rare variants that are coming up in the current screens are the place to start and to interrogate them, especially for genes that we know, you know, what their functions are or think we know what their functions are. So that I think that's something, you know, we could start to do now, and but I'd like to open that up to comments. So I would encourage anybody to raise their hand and start this discussion. Okay, Stefan.
So I think I got the impression across the groups that there was some appetite for an idea of a somewhat centralized list and some level of coordination in experiments. The vision I would have of this is that there is a prioritization of genomic loci. We can discuss how that would be with these different tiers depending on the scale of your throughput. And then there would be an RFA where people bring along their suggestion of what technology should be applied. I mean, I take the point that we do not know what we're looking for, where we're looking for, when we're looking for it. And so I think having a very, very broad camp of that technology, but by centering it around a defined set of genes, you'd have a set of data which would be very, very easy to integrate together. In the same way that in GTEx, you go and look up a gene in the genome browser, you go and look up a chromosome, we would have those genes as being a central point. I, obviously as a rare variant person, favor the de novo high impact, but I think given the common variation contribution towards these disorders, I think it needs to be a group of genes which is orientated towards both the common and the rare variant. Partly, now I think one issue from this is gonna be, there are gonna be winners and losers. There are gonna be some people whose favorite gene gets selected and some who don't, and there's gonna be some people whose favorite disorder gets selected and some who don't. But what it would give us is a concrete set of data which could be analyzed together, and then also hopefully a route forward which could be expanded to other genes and other disorders once we have an idea how to deal with this Herculean task of understanding the overall set.
Right, right. So this is something that's come up in other work groups at NIH, and something I've pushed both the Stanley Center and NIH to make a list, prioritizing genes and alleles, and I've met some resistance to do that. Maybe that resistance is changing with the progression in genetics. It'd be good to hear from NIH possibly, but Gavin, do you want to comment?
Just to say that I agree with you, Rick, and the other panelists. I agree to the extent that I put my money where my mouth is that I've staked my whole career on a risk factor because of the definitive nature of the risk factor. And so I think it would be fantastic to prioritize genes that people are confident in that cause human disease and understand those diseases well, and then study them like at every possible scale, right, in an organized way. So the question I had back to you, Rick, is like the RFA, are you imagining an RFA at the level of program project, you know, a small consortium or a series of, you know, R01s? Because I would just say that a larger scale program project type consortium around a single risk factor to look at it at every possible scale, I think would be quite exciting.
Yeah, I think that came out with our discussion in our breakout group, that this idea of you know, modeling after the cell census brain initiative programs, where they brought together, you know, many groups to collaborate and coordinate a research in characterizing various cell types, et cetera. So I think that's a really positive, beyond actually a program project grant, but a larger consortium that would approach different genes or different sets of genes. So Trey?
I would like to pose a question to the group. I'm Rebecca Beer. I'm the program director for the Functional Neurogenomics Program here at NIMH. Mm-hmm. So I heard in the discussion so far, a lot of enthusiasm for doing these types of analyses with many genes at once. And I'm interested to hear the group's opinion about how prioritization of a gene list would affect these kinds of efforts. If we say that, X, Y, and Z genes are 1, 2, and 3 on the list, is that going to discourage investigators who are interested in looking at 20, 50, 100 genes at a time?
I don't think so. I mean, I think because that's going to happen, obviously, these are really most of these disorders are polygenic disease, and they have to be looked at with many genes at a time. But I think it would help guide the general, population, the general NIMH investigators who don't follow the genetics, I've heard many cases where people propose to study this gene and then they, it just gets rejected from NIMH. So I think some guidance, that doesn't have to be dogma, but some guidance would be helpful. Trey?
Yeah, thanks, Richard. Yeah, no, I think this is a really interesting discussion and the right one to be having. And so the following is meant not as overly critical, but just to kind of stimulate discussion here. But I didn't really understand, the more I think about it, what was meant when we say we want a multi-scale approach focused on a set of genes. Because so isn't the gene level one of the scales we're talking about? So if you focus on a set of genes, which I can see the merits of, inherently you're going to have a hard time going multi-scale, at least as I understand scale, but we should talk about what we all mean by scale, of course. But as I understand it, scale would then also study going down in molecular scale to look at structure of a protein complex and a protein and individual atoms, and then going upward to look at systems of genes and pathways and organelles and cells and tissues and organisms. And so when you say multi-scale focused on genes, I question whether that's not an oxymoron. Can you have both multi-scale and focused on a set of genes?
Well, this is not just my idea, but I think people can chime in. But I view it as, we're using many of us are looking at synaptic levels, but some are looking at, for example, mouse models or zebrafish or, other model systems. We can't all do that, at the same, in one laboratory. And so having a collaborative funding mechanism where people could get around either a single gene or a set of genes and work at those different levels and promote collaboration and communication between those different levels is what the idea I'm thinking about. But others can chime in. Dan, you have your hand up?
Yeah, I also just wanted to make sure that, I think one does not want to at all squash the notion of studying a gene function, right? Its protein, its structure, its complexes, and all of that. But I think if one's making a claim that one is studying disease per se and understanding how genetic variants influence disease, then the notion of studying more than one gene becomes more important. I know that might be subtle, but I just wanted to make that clear because I want to, that we're not saying that one shouldn't be studying a single gene function, because that's how a lot of advances really come from, studying a particular, receptor or transporter or something like that, of course. But there's a distinction. Anyway.
Could I respond to Trey's comment?
Sure.
So the way I would imagine this working, so firstly, there is great value in studying one gene and understanding it's in great deal, just as Dan said. But thinking about ways of using the gene lists we have, I think looking across multiple genes is really where we're going to see this point of convergence, which hopefully is the true phenotype towards disease. The way I would imagine the scale working from a practical point of view is that you have a ranked list of genes. And if you have the sort of assay which is able to deal with 10 genes, you take the 10 top genes at the top. And if you have the sort of assay which is applicable to 200 genes, you take the entire list. And you basically fit, where does your level of assay fit onto that ranked list and use that to guide you? Now, it might be that your assay is only applicable to a subset of those genes, in which case still that ranking works, you just skip some because they're not applicable. And it would be a bit like in the ENCODE project, where there's a small number of cell lines where you've got every single assay's been done. And then there's a large number of cell lines which have got some assays done. And so it's sort of filling that matrix of all the different assays along one axis versus the 200 ranked genes or 300 ranked genes over on this side, so that your body of knowledge starts towards the top. And in prioritizing those genes, you would want to make sure that you are getting different systems and different disorders and common versus rare being prioritized, so that we could see the convergence across those main dimensions.
Yeah, so just to quickly chime in, so that made a lot of sense. And I think what you just made me realize, at least, is that there's at least two uses of the word scale here. I was thinking about scale as biological scale. Whereas I think when you use the word scale, you mean the number of genes, you know, the scale of the assay, right? Yeah. Right, the scale of the assay and the scale of biology that's the target of that assay are two different, very different concepts. And so in your use, I think you're talking scale of the assay or technology, and that makes perfect sense. Some are able to measure all genes in a wide scale type of thing, and some are able to look at one protein or one residue in a protein.
Could you define biological scale in the same, just to finish your thought there?
Well, so the way I was, I mean, understanding it from some of the talks and the conversation today was, you know, we have different biological concepts and objects of which genes occupy but one tier. And certainly we have cells, which is, cell biology is a different scale of genetics and molecular biology and a difference, which is a different scale of atomic physics. And that has to do with the, I guess if you press me, that's the nanometer or the meter measurement of the object under study. And so a gene is yay, and a residue or a protein is, on the order of tens to hundreds of nanometers, certainly if you're talking about larger protein complexes. But then, you can go to bigger objects and smaller objects. So for instance, we had a discussion, I think it was on the general call, about focusing on the synapse. Right. And so that was a proposal very similar to, I think, the one Richard made, if I'm not mistaken. But there the list would be organelles insofar as the synapse is an organelle. And so the synapse obviously is a much bigger scale object than a single gene or gene product. And that was how I was understanding the notion.
Well, I think it's scale in both directions, right? It's a scale of the number of genes your assay can measure, but also scale at the level of cells to organisms, et cetera. So I think Steve, did you have your hand up? And Ellen, I don't know if your thoughts were expressed or not.
Well, I was just going to say just express that part of the value of nudging a community toward working on the same set of genes is to create functional data sets that have cumulative value, in which the whole is more than the sum of its parts, and it's possible to computationally look across many different kinds of functional analyses of perturbations of the same genes and sort of learn from that altogether. The other thing I wanted to mention is that, ultimately, I mean, for so long, polygenicity has sort of seemed like this curse, like that it made it really hard to get to biology in these disorders. And it's been kind of true. I think it's made it really challenging to define paradigms, which I think is one reason why conversations like these ones today are important and why it is important to kind of let 100 flowers bloom, because we really don't know what the optimal paradigm is yet. But, you know, it may be that in the end, especially now that there's so much more kind of high throughput, high dimensional biology, that we'll look back and that we can make, as a community, we can make this polygenicity into a really good thing. You know, so like, just to contrast to Huntington's disease, for example, Huntington's had what, for so long it was, you know, there were so many conversations like, oh, if only schizophrenia was like Huntington's and it was really obvious what the gene was. And you had a Mendelian allele of large, or a Mendelian gene of large effect that explained most cases. And Huntington's has that. It's had that for 25, 30 years, but it's still very confusing because that gene, it's just because it's one gene doesn't solve the problem, because that gene does many different things. And it's been very hard to figure out which ones are actually part of the pathophysiology and which ones are just interesting, but not part of the pathophysiology. And in Huntington's now, there's this new chapter of progress from age of onset modifiers, which is a phenotype that actually is polygenic, but is pointing in very specific ways to very specific pathways that might be much more tractable to therapeutics. And so I'm excited by the possibility that collectively, as a field, we may be able to kind of do something similar in schizophrenia and autism, and really turn polygenicity into a strength by finding the convergence points of all of these different genes.
To add to Steve's point, I think you could help with that by selecting genes or types of genetic risk factors that may create risk for the same outcome, but clearly from genetic studies appear to do so differently. So for example, in the case of autism already, we know that there are genes that create risk for autism at a genome-wide significant level that pretty much never do so absent broader syndromic complications. And there are those like ANC2 that just kind of leave you alone otherwise for the most part. And likely this is going to become the case for schizophrenia as well. And if you work across the genes that are associated with the CNVs, the polygenicity, leveraging what they have in common in light of all their differences could actually create a more informative data set. And I think in selecting genes, it'd be great to choose some that allow you to look at what do these things have in common and what do these things, how do they differ? Why can they create risk for schizophrenia while doing or not doing this other thing?
So I think this might be a good transition to a longer term view. So they're short term and long term strategies. So I think the polygenicity has strengths as expressed by Steve, Elise, and others. But I think that's, you know, to my mind, that's a very complex process and will take additional studies. We've heard from Kevin earlier about, you know, cell villages to try to address polygenicity. So maybe we could turn to how to address polygenicity and in the long term. So anybody would address that or have other ideas for long-term approaches? So Dan?
I just want to add one point to that without addressing the long-term issue, is that to just emphasize Steve's point, there are also numerous dozens of examples of drugs used in humans whose targets are GWAS hits. So because of the small effect size, it doesn't limit its kind of applicability to kind of being central. Effect size of mutation maybe, you know, it isn't the same, right, as kind of a key pathway in disease. And I think we have to recognize that. And also I'll just shut up.
No, great point. All right, other comments? So one thing we haven't talked about is, you know, sort of other model systems and the long term, I think we will have to go to other model systems such as primates or marmosets or other approaches. We have not talked about really phenotyping, phenotyping and patient stratification. You know, these things are going to be absolutely necessary, I think, going forward. So I don't know if people want to address those issues.
Are people getting Zoom fatigue?
4 months ago.
You should have Zoom tolerance built up by now.
I think it's only appropriate that the sun is setting across my face right now. So.
I have a question. I just rather than a statement, and it's more to people who are studying basic mechanisms. If we identify genes, let's say that we know cause, let's say autism, intellectual disability, epilepsy, et cetera, maybe even autism or schizophrenia, whatever. And now one makes a mutation in an animal or in a system. Do you think, how does one approach understanding that kind of genotype to phenotype issue? Or does one basically, is it sufficient, and I'm not saying it's not, I would agree that it is sufficient to just understand what that mutation, what that gene is actually doing, and without kind of connecting it to some human behavior directly, but, you know, given all the pleiotropy of these loci.
Well, I think, you know, obviously this is an issue with NIMH that, you know, it's hard to study schizophrenia in a mouse or a zebrafish. And so I think there has been, a movement to study it in primates, which are closer to us in behaviors, and to study them with some of these genetic modifications. But personally, I think that studying these genes and in models such as zebrafish and mouse models are really critical to understanding the biological function, and that's going to play a role in how we approach mutations in these genes in schizophrenia.
I feel like it kind of goes back to Steve's point about the what exactly is going on with the Huntington's disease gene that's of relevance to the disease, and again, where one can leverage the benefit of having many genes and many mechanisms of genetic risk, where you attempt to find the intersecting points among kind of the broad mess of consequences that all these things can create.
Well, not only find them, but quantify them too. So, for example, maybe in dendritic spines, we're already seeing that kind of polygenic convergence. But trying to show how does that relate to, say, the microglia story or synaptic pruning story, and be able to put an effect size on those across multiple genes. You can imagine that network being a way to really start to understand what are the common factors across multiple different loci, and to what extent they seem to matter.
Yes, and in our subgroup, Stefan brought this up. Do we expect similar phenotypes with these different risk genes? In genes that are involved in synapses versus genes that are involved in chromatin remodeling, are we going to get the same phenotype? And when we assay them in our different systems, do we expect that? Should that be an expectation? So that guy, I have Gavin and Helen.
Yeah, so I would argue the reason why we've known the gene in Huntington's, but we don't understand the disease mechanism, is because we don't understand movement and movement disorders at the neurobiological level. And so I think that that to me is why I personally think we should look at rare variants with huge effect and study them at multiple biological scales. So we get a better understanding of, like, we can come to a consensus as a field of, like, well, these risk factors for autism affect principally these circuits in cortex and striatum relative to the rest of the brain. Or these schizophrenia risk factors seem to affect these circuits, you know, in this area of the brain. I don't even think there's that kind of consensus yet. And so, you know, just understanding basic biological mechanisms that are associated with neural domains of these human disorders, I think we need to understand. And I think the fastest way to get there is to take these rare variants that were common.
All right, Alan.
Yeah, thank you. So most of my points have just been summarized, so I'll be brief, but especially what Elise said, you know, each one of these large effect rare variants may have many different phenotypes when you knock them out in, for example, a model organism. And how to know which one of those is actually relevant to the disorder is hard. And so maybe that's why, you know, Huntington's has been historically difficult, because there's only one gene. Rayborg now, you know, with things like autism and schizophrenia, because we can look at many different genes in parallel, we can now figure out what are the common phenotypes, right? That's the key thing to figure out. And that will lead us towards the relevant cell types, brain regions, and things like that to be able to move forward. And so I think the organisms where we can do many genes in parallel will be very useful as a first step to figure out where to look, right? And then you take those into more sophisticated, lower throughput sort of studies to actually get towards fundamental mechanisms.
All right, great. Alan?
Yes, I want to come back to Dan's question, because I think that in terms of the animal model systems, I think that, you know, looking at basic biological mechanisms is going to be relevant for understanding the function of these genes. And I think most people on the panel would agree that I don't think you have to necessarily recapitulate a human behavior or human-like behavior in an animal for that to be relevant. I think that's clear. But I think that one of the challenges in terms of modeling risk genes in animal models is sort of, are all mutations the same? And so, for example, are you modeling, when we say we want to model, you know, we'll take the top risk genes. I agree, in my lab, we study high confidence risk genes, but do you model then loss of function? Do you recapitulate a patient-specific mutation? Are all loss of function mutations the same? Are some dominant negative mutations? I mean, how do we want to think about that? And also, it's likely that genetic background plays a role, so that the same risk gene might confer risk to autism and schizophrenia. I think that that's more complicated in terms of trying to figure out. But I do think that in terms of trying to understand the basic biology of these genes or how they affect synapse function or synapse formation or affect particular cell types will be relevant and is the role of the animal models.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why we need a sort of a funnel mechanism where we're broadly, you know, surveying many of the risk genes and alleles, and then, you know, only doing, you know, having consensus to generate these very expensive models, such as marmoset models, to screen them further. All right, other comments? So what about, I think we're coming to the end of our time, but what about, you know, looking long-term in developing therapeutics, because that's where we want to go. And to generate therapeutics, whether it's genetic therapeutics, you know, small molecule therapeutics, how do we get there? You know, we can do high throughput screens. We can do test in animal models. How do we get to a druggable or therapeutic
Yeah, so I have some questions about this. It's an area that I and my team have been grappling with. I just wanted to share what we observe in our data. We study genome-wide epigenetics, genome-wide looping interactions, and what we see in our IPS models of either common variant-driven diseases or rare variant-driven diseases across multiple disease states is that there may be a GWAS hit or a fine-mapped variant that in turn, you know, gains an ataxic peak and is thought to be so-called causal variant. And one could think about, okay, we should target potentially the causal variant that shows up in the GWAS and then gains an ataxic peak. But then what we also see is that in addition, there could be upwards, depending on the model, of 100,000 genome-wide additional gained epigenetic marks or 20,000 altered loops. And this is a severe unraveling of the cellular state, independent of the genetics underneath these sites. And so I suppose I just wanted to learn people's perspective. Do we think that the GWAS hit is the driving event that then causes these epigenetic, massive epigenetic changes? Is it under consideration that in these perturbation studies, we should also determine the direct functionality of the epigenetic marks that are not at the causal variant? And then why I'm leading to it for this question is, so then which ones are the therapeutic targets? What if the epigenetic marks that aren't at the GWAS hit are actually have stronger effect size or more functional, should we be going to those as the therapeutic target, or should we be going to the primary GWAS hit? And I don't know the answers to any of these, but we're certainly grappling quite a bit.
Comments on that? So Stefan again.
So I think it's very hard to imagine developing therapeutics until we can answer some very basic questions. For example, what epigenetic factors matter? What cell type is important? What species can you replicate these effects in? It's very hard to imagine a screen which you could have an endpoint and take forward for until we've answered those kind of basic questions. I do think one point of early traction is nucleotide-based therapies, so it's like gene replacement or CRISPR editing, CRISPR-I, CRISPR-ASOs, towards some of the neurodevelopmental ones, with the goal firstly of creating some benefit in a small number of people, but asking the central question in autism of when can it be treated, which right now seems a major, major sticking point in terms of therapeutics. I think that's maybe less of a concern in other disorders where we have something like antipsychotics where we know there is ability to modify. So in autism, the low-hanging fruit looks to be gene therapy approaches in a small number of genes, probably in people who are more severely affected, because that's going to be easier from an FDA point of view. But I find it very, very difficult to imagine screening for other disorders until we have a better idea of what we're screening in and what we're trying to see change.
Yeah, of course, I would agree with that, because I think that, these are developmental disorders, right? So one key factor, of course, is when we treat and how we treat. And so some of these, especially the haploinsufficiencies, are at the low-hanging fruit in my mind, that there are, you know, relatively large numbers of the intellectual disability and developmental disorder mutations, de novo mutations that lead to haploinsufficiency that could be addressed through antisense oligo approaches, which have revolutionized many of these disorders, hopefully, and are very and as well as possible genetic rescue. And I think that's a proof of principle in impacting cognitive disorders. It's the most rapid way to really show that we can do that. But of course, developing an idea of when to treat these, do we have to treat at what age, for intellectual disability earlier, for schizophrenia, is it, before the onset of symptoms, so I think these are really important questions. All right, any other comments?
Uh, I'll just say, but at the same time, the treatments that we currently have for many of these disorders, we really don't have a clear idea of the mechanism of how they're working. And yet these are the, you know, approved treatments for these disorders. So I would agree. I think our goal is to achieve more of a mechanism-based, a molecular identification, approved treatments. But at the same time, if we find a drug that modifies behavior that might be relevant, that may also be useful, even if we have to study the mechanism as sort of a next step. Just want to put that out there, that might also be relevant and be an improvement on what we have now as existing treatments.
Yeah. If I could just follow, I was going to say the exact same thing. Is the psychiatric disorders are defined by behavior alterations, and we know the circuits drive behavior, and so if we can figure out ways to modify selectively circuits that we know underlie certain behaviors, then maybe you can intervene downstream in a bunch of genetically distinct disorders because they may share common behavioral phenotypes. But it even emphasizes more the need to understand biological mechanisms to drive behavior.
All right, so I'm getting a notice that we're coming to an end here. Gita specifically asked, what do we think about next steps? What are...
Would it be okay for one of the public to chime in? This is Stuart Anderson. I've been working on schizophrenia and neurobiology, both as a clinician, as a scientist for 25 years. Could I make a point?
Make it very quick, because we have 10 minutes until we're shut out again. We go back down the wormhole.
Got it. So there has actually been a number of studies that have some clinical relevance in particular circuit related to the ventral hippocampus, papers in Cell Molecular Psychiatry, Biological Psychiatry, all within the last year, papers in PNAS and Molecular Psychiatry within the last 5 years, a hypothesis elaborated by Tony Grace 20 years ago with a circuit involving ventral hippocampal hyperactivity activating the ventral tegmentum dopamine circuit via the nucleus accumbens. Interneuron transplants into the MG, into the hippocampus can correct psychosis-related behaviors in 22q mice and in MAM model rats and in cyclin D2 mice, so a variety of models that all share this ventral hippocampal hyperactivity, and humans that are psychotic have anterior hippocampal hyperactivity. I simply bring this up that there actually is targetable circuitry. And the idea that I think is from my perspective, that the future is likely to hold this kind of focal circuit-based gene therapy using chemogenetics rather than interneuron transplants, probably, as the more recent studies are using chemogenetics, is likely to be one place that there's going to be progress in the future. It's not going to solve every problem a person with schizophrenia has, for sure, but it might make their quality of life a lot better. Just want to say that.
Great. So I think that this is, we have not talked about this really circuit-based approaches. Obviously, all these phenotypes are circuit-based and using approaches to directly target the circuit rather than the gene or the allele. So we have a few minutes, and I just want to end. Obviously, I can't summarize the whole day, especially after 7 hours of Zoom and the sun setting in front of me. But I do want to, end on an optimistic note. I think many of we're all here because we think this is really a turning point in psychiatry in general, at least I do, that that we've come a long way in the genetics, that we are really getting tractable genes and alleles that are risk genes with high effect sizes and and many and some causal, especially with autism and intellectual disability genes. So I think there is an amazing progress, and but this is not going to be easy going forward. I think that's why we're all here together, that we need approaches at many different levels to address these. We still don't know the appropriate phenotypes in our various assay systems, but we have, I think, the beginning of a hold on mechanisms, certainly a focus on both the chromatin modifiers and on the synapse, but also on inflammatory pathways. And so I think we can start to interrogate these at many levels, I think both at the single gene level, but also, as we talked about, at a polygenic level. So I think this is going to require, as we've discussed today, many different levels from, two-dimensional cultures, organoids, different model systems. That each different model system brings different strengths. And in many ways, we don't speak the same language. This is something coming as a biochemist, molecular biologist, learning genetics, and luckily I've been learning it from some of the best people over the last 10 years. So I think that's an issue for us as well to start interacting and speaking the same language. So I think if NIMH can really help promote these interactions and consortiums that could address this at all levels, that would make the advance of the field tremendously. So I think that's maybe the next steps is really to ask NIH to help us and really help us communicate, interact, the shared data and approaches. And I think the PGC is a great example of how coming together really has made a big difference.
Thank you, Jude, and thank you to the chairs, Annie, Steve, for working with us past 6 weeks now to develop this agenda, identifying speakers, panelists. So thank you to you both, Rebecca Bard, and thank the speakers, moderators, summarizers, and panelists for spending so much time on this virtual space and making this a productive meeting. Really appreciate your time and all the incredibly useful comments you made and the questions you raised. Steve, Annie, do you have any final comments before we adjourn?
I want to thank everyone for contributing their time and their ideas. I couldn't be happier about who participated or how they participated, and just seeing the ferment of ideas in the field, and the not just the new genetic results, but like the new kinds of ways of analyzing biology that people are making possible, and the collection of ideas and ways of thinking around this. It's hard not to be excited about the possibility and to feel like this is a moment of real opportunity.
I second that. Thank you to everyone for participating. It's a great day.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you all. Bye.